We're in 2 Kings chapter 9, message 51, and I've entitled this, and really before we look at Jehu, Jezebel, Joram, and Ahaziah, before we look at their death, where we've been leading up to has been to Jezreel. So Jezreel is an interesting place in the Old Testament. When you think about Oklahoma City, I still remember, you know, Oklahoma City bombing. When you think about now, when someone mentions the World Trade Center, you think about that, you're going to think about what has happened at 9/11. Even when you hear 9/11, you're going to think immediately of that. There's so many different things. Hiroshima, when you think about Hiroshima, or you think about Pearl Harbor, you're not going to think about Pearl Harbor as a place that maybe was touristy. You're going to think about the bombing. And the same when it comes to our text today, Jezreel is a place in the Old Testament and in the New that has a certain connotation that we're going to find out today. So our introduction this morning is very simple. It's very basic and kind of funny and at the same time kind of scary. So when these things go together, bad things happen. And maybe you can think of more of these things. I have a whole list. These are the ones that I just kind of included. When these things go together, bad things happen. Electricity and water. Okay? Probably not good. How about lead, paint, and asbestos? And you can read reports of that where that was just kind of common all the time. Diabetes and heart failure. How about bleach and ammonia? There are certain chemicals even under your sink that if you accidentally put them together, no bueno. COVID, even we've heard this before, COVID and underlying health issues, some that had other health issues with that. How about sedatives of any sort and alcohol, even illegal drugs and alcohol? There's a whole host of them. How about drinking and driving? These are things that are bad, that don't go good together. Heat and humidity, which I love the winter because right now that's out. Bacon and chocolate. Remember when we were in Hartford, they had just opened a Cabela's in Hartford, 2010 or 11, and we're going into the Cabela's, and they had bacon on a stick, chocolate-covered bacon. They had this vendor out there. I'm like, what is this madness? And some people like that, but to me, I did get one just so I could have it. I even took a picture of it on my little phone when the kids were little, and it tasted about as what you would think it would taste. But personally, bacon and chocolate, no bueno. How about cats and bathwater? I don't know. Usually any pets. Children and vegetables, probably not good. Revenge and social media. And you do see that. There's things called catfishing or swatting. People are doing these kind of things to calling, you know, there's some emergency, some problem. They're showing up at even at some congressmen and senators' homes. They're doing this. Or revenge in social media. How about gas station food and long road trips? Probably not a dangerous concoction. I love this one, arsenic and old lace. And again, it's the kind of the dark comedy that was written and produced into a movie. And then, of course, we get to where we're going. Things that go together, bad things occur. Ahab and Jezebel, Jehu and Jezreel. All of these things, you put these two elements together. And even when Alfred Nobel, when you study about his life and you see Alfred Nobel, you've got the Nobel Peace Prize, which he's known for, but he actually invented dynamite. So when you think about when the newspaper at the time ran the report of his death, they actually had it wrong. It was his brother that had died. And when he saw the headline as a man that was alive reading, you know, the merchant of death has died, he read this article. He's like, this is how people think of me? So he then set out to change his name and the way people viewed him by saying, I'm going to give this prize or this thing for people who actually want to bring life and health to our world and humanity. But certain elements went together to make dynamite. And if those elements are together at the right, you know, it went through a whole iteration and a lot of people lost their lives. You read stories about it, but Dynamite has certain elements. When you put it together, boom. Jehu and Jezreel, when these two elements get together, boom. So just 2 weeks ago, before the last Wednesday, Pastor West and I were talking, I think on a Wednesday afternoon, or maybe it was on a Monday, and I'm going over my notes, and I said, you know, I'm studying this, and Jehu, and we were talking, I said, it's just, he's like an enigma. Jehu comes out of nowhere, and he immediately kills, under the direction of God, three political, we won't say opponents, but he takes out the ruling dynasty for the last 60 years, and they're all related. You got a grand, again, you've got a son, a nephew, you've got like an uncle, you've got all these people, which Jezebel at the head, and it sets in chain of motion all of these events that happen. But Jehu comes out of nowhere, and he's kind of an uncontrollable guy with what he says and what he does. I'm at my desk, Pastor Weston's there, we're just talking. I said, he's like Trump. This is not a political thing. I'm not saying that. But I said, I even wrote in my notes, this is 2 weeks ago, I'm like, he's like, this Jehu guy is Trump-like. Now, in regards to who Jehu is, Jehu was not like Trump in that Jehu was a general in Ahab's army, so he was a military leader that already saw, you know, we won't say politics, but he saw this. But what he did when he was anointed was kind of bloody. It was ugly. We were talking about it at dinner last night, after dinner with the kids, and Allie came in the room after I'm studying, I'm talking to her about this because she's doing forensics right now with these crime things. She's having to study, and she's listening to some podcasts, and we're watching some things together, and she's talking about, you know, the crime scenes and different things. And I said, Allie, if you had to go to the crime scene in Jezreel and there's just a set of hands and feet, what would you say to that? She said, what are you talking about, Dad? I said, well, Jezebel, the dogs came and ate everything. It was like disgusting. And this is who Jehu is. He takes care of Jezebel, of the two other kings, and it sets all these things. And it's so interesting that Jezreel in the Old Testament is going to be mentioned in Revelation chapter 16. It's future as well. Jezreel today is a location that is very beautiful, that is very great, but the place Jezreel, the Jehu and Jezreel, it's been the site of many battles, and interestingly, even over the last 70 years to 100 years, it's been the place where the world war, where it was, I won't say settled, but where the enemy was pushed back in Jezreel. We're going to see that. And also in 1948, the establishment of Israel, Jezreel. So we're not just talking about, you know, dusty books with history lessons. We're actually talking about future events that will occur and Jehu-like figures that will emerge, whether it's a Trump-like figure or it's someone on the national scene. You got to think, in the Old Testament, Daniel talks about a man named Antiochus Epiphanes, or however you want to say this, this guy who was the Antichrist-type figure that was going to do something that when you look back on, and from the Revelation looking back, it talks about this man that will rise out of this group, and we always look at people politically, globally, that are rising up, and all across the globe, this is happening. Some people looked at Erdogan, the Prime Minister of Turkey, or his name's Alexis, but I can't remember his last name, I can't really pronounce it, but he's the Greek Prime Minister, and then some people look at the Ukrainian, Zelensky, they look at France's Prime Minister, Macron. And all of these men who have risen up to power, everyone looks at them and say, is this the one? Is this the one? Is this the one? But also on the positive end, they look at them and they try to bring correlation. They're all who they are, but not only does God have a plan, so does the devil. But when you put two elements together, as we're going to see, it can be combustible. There are certain people that when we send them as the American people to Washington, something happens, good and bad, and sometimes unpredictable. And this is what happens when Jehu gets to Jezreel. Just close the doors, get under the bed, get in the wherever, because it's about to go down, and this is what's going to happen. So look at your text, 2 Kings chapter 9, kind of a long introduction, but we've read this multiple times, so we won't read all of this, but look at verse 1. Elisha the prophet called one of the children of the prophets. He's one of the Bible college students, said to him, gird up your loins, go take a box of oil in your hand, go to Ramoth Gilead. This is where the generals, they've been fighting against Hazael, this wicked king who committed assassination treason against his king. They're fighting against him. Go down here in verse 2. When you come, find Jehu. Go in, make him arise among his brethren, carry him to an inner chamber, take the box of oil, pour it on his head, and say, you're the king. Then get out. I mean, even the instruction is, it's about to go down. Get out of there. Verse 4, the young man, the prophet, went to Ramoth Gilead, came, captains of the host are sitting. Verse 6, he arose, went into the house, poured the oil on his head, said to him, verse 7, you're going to smite the house of Ahab, thy master. Remember, Jehu was a general under Ahab. So he's actually leading the charge and fighting battles. That I may avenge the blood of my servants, the prophets, the blood of the servants of the Lord at the hand of Jezebel. The whole house of Ahab shall perish. I'm going to cut off the line. Everyone in that house is going to die. Verse 9, I will make the house of Ahab like the house of Jeroboam. Verse 10, the dog shall eat Jezebel. They will eat her in the portion of Jezreel, and there shall be none to bury her. And he opened the door and fled. Interesting. And you go to all the way down to verse 14. So Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshi, conspired against Joram. Now, as you have your place there, turn over to 1 Kings 21. Just turn to 1 Kings 21. And as you're turning there, I'll just read to you, number one, we're saying Jehu is God's battle axe. What do you do with a battle axe? I mean, what's the purpose of that? If you show up to work with a battle axe, you'll be like, you okay? What's your problem? What's going on here? You don't show up with a bazooka when you work in a cubicle or at the post office. You do that, they'll be like, maybe meet that guy at the door. Jehu is a battle axe. He's got that personality, as we see by the description of when he's riding to Jezreel. They're looking out, watching, and this guy's riding furiously. And I guess for us, maybe we would liken it to the way someone drives. I don't know if we can all see that, but if someone drives like a crazy person, oh boy, here comes whatever you want to say. Here comes Linda, or here comes Jimmy, oh boy, look at him. Well, he's riding in, and 2 Kings chapter 9 says he's riding. They're like, that looks like Jehu. He's coming in furiously. So he's God's battle axe. A, B, and C under these points we've already covered. Elisha instructed this unnamed prophet. Jehu is anointed and commissioned, and then he's declared king. So back in 1 Kings 21, I want you just to note some of the terms, Jezreel, how often it's mentioned. Look at verse 1. And it came to pass after these things that Naboth the Jezreelite, had a vineyard, which was in Jezreel, of course, if he's a Jezreelite, hard by the palace of Ahab. Ahab said to Naboth, give me your vineyard. I want a vegetable garden, a garden of herbs. It's near to my house, and I'll give you a better one. If it's good to you, I'll give you whatever it's worth. Naboth said, verse 3, the Lord forbid it that I should give the inheritance of my fathers to thee. I'm not going to give it to you. It's been in my family for generations. This is given to us all the way back. Ahab came to his house heavy and displeased because of the word which Naboth the Jezreelite had spoken to him. For he said, I will not give it to you. And he laid on his bed, turned away his face, and he would eat no bread. I'm going to pout, Ahab. But Jezebel, his wife, came to him and said, why are you sad? Why aren't you eating? Verse 6, because I spake to Naboth the Jezreelite, said, give me your vineyard, or if it please thee, I'll give you another one. He says, I won't do it. Verse 7, and his wife said, dost thou now govern the kingdom of Israel? Aren't you the king? Get up, have supper, be happy. I will give thee the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite. So she wrote letters. She forged letters in her husband's name, sealed them with a seal, sent the letters to the elders, basically to the mayor of the city of Jezreel, to the elders of the town, the city leaders, about dwelling with Naboth. And she wrote in the letter saying, proclaim a fast at Naboth on high and set two false witnesses, sons of Belial, before him to bear witness against him, bear false witness, saying, you blaspheme God and the king, and then carry him out and stone him. Can you see how this happens in our modern day? Just lie about someone. It doesn't matter. Just lie. Get them out. Whatever it is, any case. It could be a guy that owns a vineyard. It could be anyone. So just do this. And when you do that, then carry him out and stone him so he'll die. And the men of his city, the elders, the nobles, I just think of these guys. They got to know Ahab and Jezebel. They know what's going on, and they just go along with it. And so they did this. They proclaimed a fast at Naboth above the people. They came in, verse 13, set before him. They witnessed against him in the presence of the people, and they said, he blasphemed God. And they carried him out. They stoned him with stones, and he died. They sent to Jezebel, saying, Naboth is stoned. He's dead. And it came to pass when Jezebel heard it, she said to Jezebel, take your possession. Go get it of Naboth the Jezreelite, which he refused to give thee, for he's not alive. He's dead. Came to pass when Ahab heard it, he went down to the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite to take possession of it. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah, saying, go down to meet Ahab, which is in Samaria. He's in the vineyard of Naboth. Where is that? In Jezreel. Elijah, go down there, because he's going to possess it. And you'll say to him, verse 19, have you killed and taken possession? You'll say to him, thus saith the Lord, in the place where the dogs lick the blood of Naboth, shall dogs lick thy blood. We've already covered him. So Ahab met his demise. He was the blood, the dogs licked it right there, Jezreel. Even Ahab said to Elijah, hast thou found me, O mine enemy? And he answered, I have found thee, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. Behold, I will bring evil upon thee. I will take away thy posterity. In fact, this is exactly what this young man said to Jehu. He repeated the same phrase. I'm going to cut from Ahab him that pisseth against the wall and him that is shut up and left in Israel. He says, there'll be no more children from this line. I'll make thine house like the house of Jeroboam. He's going all the way down, for you provoke me to anger. Verse 23, and Jezebel also spake the Lord, saying, the dog shall eat Jezebel by the wall of Jezreel. Him that dieth of Ahab in the city shall dogs eat him, and him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat. So here we see that Jezreel is a place that, can we just fast forward? Can I give you the cliff notes? Can I just tell you the end of this? In Revelation chapter 16 and Revelation chapter 19, the Bible says that the blood will be up to the bridal's bits at the Battle of Armageddon, and the fowls of the air will eat the bodies of those that have come to set themselves against the Lord. Let's just leapfrog over the notes to the end here. Jezreel in the Old Testament is Megiddo, Armageddon in the New Testament. Did you know that? The Valley of Jezreel and the Valley or the Battle of Armageddon, these are the same, it's the same location. So all throughout history, and ultimately the ones who are the enemies of God will come to this particular plain, valley, where there have been multiple battles, and they will set themselves against God. And just like Jezebel and Ahab were, boom, and the dogs, the birds, will lick their blood or eat. I mean, it's disgusting. You can just see how all roads lead to Jezreel. It literally is the case. John talks about it in Revelation. So look at number one under letter C. Context is important. What's the context of what we've been talking about for the last really 2 months? Context here. Ahaziah is 22. So he's just 2 years younger than Pastor Weston. Now just think, you've got a 22-year-old king. His father died after 8 years. He had some issue. He co-reigned with his father for 12 years, but after 8 years, there's some issue. So, and he wasn't a good guy. He dies. His mother, Ahaziah's mother, okay, is Jezebel and Ahab's daughter. And she kind of is pulling the strings, okay? Ahaziah is the 22-year-old wicked king of Judah, the grandson of Ahab and Jezebel, the son of their daughter, Athaliah, who basically this kid will only reign 1 year. And afterwards, once Jehu does what he's going to do, once Jehu comes in there, he takes care of Jezebel, Joram or Jehoram, and Ahaziah, you know what Athaliah is going to do? She's going to take the throne because now her son is dead, and she's going to go and start killing all of the line of David. She is a wicked, she's just like her mama. The apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. So context is important, letter B. Joram, the wicked king of Israel, is Ahaziah's uncle, Ahab and Jezebel's son. He's the brother to, I mean, we get this, but in when we're thinking about, you know, when we look at, we've talked about 60 years ago, when the Kennedy, John Kennedy was killed 60 years ago this last year, in 1963 in November. If you think about the line, whether it's the Kennedys, the Bushes, the Bidens, the Obamas, or whoever it might be, when you think about the line of people there, you can see that in this line, the line of Omri, this is Ahab's father, they are bad news. And they won't leave. They won't go away. And the only way that they are gotten rid of is through divine edict by God and through a not a rogue general, but someone that is like a battle axe that just comes in there with fury. And just, it's really gruesome. It's no coincidence that in the New Testament, in the book of Revelation, more than once, at the beginning and at the end, there's a name that's familiar in the New Testament that you don't see in other times other than in this book here, 2 Kings and 1 Kings, and the name is Jezebel. And in fact, John, in writing to the churches under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says to the churches, you are suffering that woman, Jezebel. And then it talks about a Jezebel spirit. Then it even talks about the woman and later on in Revelation, by the same name. So this whole Jezebel spirit, they've got to rid themselves of this. Israel is under the spell, and now Judah, of the house of Omri, the house of Ahab, the house of Jezebel. Letter C. Both kings, Joram and Ahaziah, are fighting against Hazael. Three bad dudes, hombres, as they would say. Serious king until Joram was wounded in battle. So the older uncle is wounded in battle, the son of Ahab and Jezebel. So where does he go? He goes to Jezreel, where his mama lives, Jezebel. Later on in our notes, we see this, but Omri's palace was in Samaria. So imagine if the White House, which is in Washington, if there was another White House, let's just say it's White House South, it's Atlanta or Raleigh or
Stark.
Where?
Stark.
Wow. Or Stark. So you've got these two. So you have a place like Jezreel, which is not hot. Whereas Samaria, the climate's a little different, and Jezreel is up on the mountains. If you go look at these things, a part of this, you can overlook, and then you can see the entire plain, because Jezreel is just not the large plain. But there's also this rocky terrain where they had built this little, we would say castle, but their fortress. It's a military city. And so Ahab wanted another palace. We talked about this a year ago when we were dealing with Elisha. So he built a palace 20 miles south of his father's palace. So he had two of them. And that was the place where they would winter, where it would be more pleasant. And Jezebel, that's where she stayed, Jezreel. So when her son, Joram, is injured, he comes to Jezreel. And then here comes the nephew along saying, oh, he's injured. Let's a family get together. Letter E, his young nephew, Ahaziah, came to Jezreel to visit him. And thus the plan came together. All roads lead to Jezreel. You know, it's just interesting, as we see letter D, that the two Hebrew root words meaning Jezreel, there's two words. It means to sow and almighty. And so we put those together, and you can just look at the Hebrew Old Testament. You can look at the terms there. It means God will sow or scatter. And that metaphor is implying that actions reap consequences. You do something and you sow something, and it's going to come to fruition. It's the same that's going to happen when the armies of the devil, the armies of the world gather against Christ. They are gathered in the same place that we're going to see Jezebel meets her final demise. It's interesting. The very place that she, we would say, forged the letter about Naboth the Jezreelite is going to be the same place where she's going to face the firing squad, the judgment of God. Number two, the Valley of Jezreel is a beautiful open plain stretching from Mount Carmel to the Jordan River, goes between three mountains, the mountains of Ephraim and Galilee. Nazareth lies on the hills on the northern side of the valley. In fact, I have this later on in our notes, but where Jesus is from, Nazareth, it's just north of there. And so the location. Number three, the Via Maris, known as the Way of Sea. There's two ancient highways that link Mesopotamia and Egypt. When you look all throughout historical accounts, this particular passageway has been used by the Ottomans, it's been used by the Egyptians, it's been used by the Mesopotamians, all of them to either for battle prowess, to have a good place to fight or to stand against an enemy. But it's also another highway, it's called the Way of the Patriarchs, which linked Jezreel with Shechem, Samaria, Bethel, and Jerusalem. The patriarchs, think about Abraham, Shechem. So this passageway is where even the patriarchs traveled for. Jezreel was the site of many important battles. Deborah and Barak's victory over Sisera. Gideon's triumph over the Midianites. Jezreel is where Saul and his son Jonathan and his other sons all died. In fact, Saul committed suicide. It was in Jezreel. King Josiah, this is going to be later, he's going to die. He's going to be defeated by the Egyptians in this very place. Ahab built a palace in Jezreel. We just said that, 20 miles south, to rival what his father had done. Number six, Ahab ran to Jezreel following the defeat of the prophets on Mount Carmel. Do you remember that? The rain was coming. And it says that Elijah outran him. I mean, he took off and the rain was coming. It hadn't rained in 3.5 years. Where did they go? They went to Jezreel. It was from this winter palace that he ruled with his domineering and evil wife, Jezebel. You know this? Naboth owned a vineyard in Jezreel. Imagine owning next to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington. You own the property next to it, whatever. Or if it's White House South in Stark and you own, I don't know, Theresa. Is that what it would be? We want that property. No. Well, we're going to get that property one way or another. Again, Naboth 8. Elijah met Ahab for the final time. The last time Elijah spoke to Ahab was in Jezreel. He said to him, this is it. You're done. You're done. The end of the story in the text we read, which we read over 2 years ago, Ahab repented. Ahab at the end of this said, he tore his clothes. He said, I'm sorry. And so God told Elijah to tell Ahab, okay, this won't happen while you're alive, but when you're dead and gone, it's going to happen to your kids. It will happen to you. Jezebel never repented. Ahab did repent. Number nine, quickly, Jezreel is the name of the son of the prophet Hosea. Hosea was told, we know the story, won't get into that, but one of the kids was named Jezreel, which was basically saying God was going to avenge the blood of what happened here. And 30 years later, the Assyrians invade. It's a bad scene. The city of Nazareth was on the northern side of Jezreel. So Jezreel is a very central location. 11, and we're almost done. In our modern era, Jezreel, it was in Jezreel that the British routed the Turks in 1917. Just go back and read it. Allenby is his name, a good British general. They actually surrendered. It took one day. It was in Jezreel. One day, the British said, we're done. They showed up and they surrendered. The fledgling Israeli army defeated an Iraqi contingent in 1948 in Jezreel. Today, Jezreel is a fertile plain. There's wheat, cotton, sunflowers. There's sheep, cattle. I mean, go look up Google pictures of Jezreel. It's absolutely beautiful. So when you Picture what John says about blood up to the horse's bridle, the entire plain. It's kind of a gruesome picture. Finally, the Old Testament name Jezreel is different. In the New Testament, it's known as the Valley of Megiddo, the spot of Armageddon. So therefore, it's interesting how God uses places and faces to bring about his divine judgment. All roads lead to Jezreel. So when we look at our world, our political system, where we are in America, we do have figures that are a lot like Jezebel in politics, or Jehu, or Ahab. You know, we got to have somebody to bail him out, but he's still a conniving, sniveling little snake, right? You've got people like that. You've all throughout. You've got the Solomons. You have the Davids. You have these types of figures. Doesn't mean that's who they are, but the personality. But all roads lead to Jezreel. Not meaning that everything is just going to go to hell in a handbasket and it's just going to blow up, but that God is sovereign over it. God knows what's going to happen. In fact, Satan actually believes he's going to win. How ridiculous. But he's read this cover to cover. He knows it. He's lived it. He's seen it. He's been there. But he still believes, and he's going to get other people to follow him and believe through the Antichrist, we're actually going to defeat God. We're going to win. And all Jesus does when he's riding back, read it, Revelation 19, he just, the word of his power, he just opens up and it says, a sword goes out, which is the word of God. He just speaks the word. Boom. If he can speak the word and the worlds come into existence, let there be light. Boom. Flings the planets from his fingertips, so to speak. I don't know how that happened, but just speaks the word. It's in Jezreel. So we can take comfort in knowing Naboth's family, it went 3 decades. It went a while. And now here we are, finally. Jezebel's there. Her son's lying in the bed. She's caring for him. The nephew shows up. And I don't know where Athaliah is, but she's not far behind. And Jehu is riding furiously in his tank, coming, bringing the battle axe with him. So when we get here next week, I've delayed on the bloodiness, but the bloodiness is coming, and we will hit that next week. Let's pray.